Now we have our first athlete, and it is our sister of in India, when it's been planning and have the privilege and honor to introduce the panel. Dr. Mohammed Salim, Director of Law at the Law College, Mr. Kabir Khanna, Pro Vice Chancellor, and School of Law, G.D. Goenka University and founder Technolex, and Ms. Anu Sura, Senior Associate PSL Advocates, and Ms. Seema Jingan, Partner and Co-founder Lex Council Law Offices. Session Chair, Ms. Shashikala Gurpur, Director of Symbiosis Law School, Pune, and Dean of the Faculty of Law, Symbiosis International University. Ladies and gentlemen, we've got a very, very interesting discussion coming up. It's about the future of legal education in India. Where is it headed? All right, here we go.
I'm Dr. Shashikala Gurpur. Some of the audience might be familiar with me. I have a very learned panel with me. Actually, my own introduction is I am the director of the Symbiosis Law School since 2007, and simultaneously I manage the profile of being the Dean Faculty of Law of Symbiosis International University. We have got three other law schools under our ambit, one in Noida, one in Hyderabad, and one in Nagpur. As you all know that this is my privilege to be chairing this session with this August body. The August body consists of very young professionals as much as young legal education leaders. It's a 40 under 40 kind of occasion. So I don't know if I was mistaken to be 40 or I was given the chair role because I am much above 40. Either ways, it's a privilege. You feel young in the company of the young, as Advocate Ram Jethmalani used to say, that it rubs off a lot of youth and it never makes you to feel aging. And age is only a matter of number, and youth is something of a mindset. So the theme of today's is the future of legal education in India. Where is it headed? To discuss this theme, I have learned colleagues from the legal education field, which includes Director Mohammed Salim of Lloyd Law School, Noida. And another young leader, Tabriz Ahmed, who is the Pro Vice Chancellor, as well as Dean Faculty of Law in the G.D. Goenka University, who is also an entrepreneur in terms of being the founder of Technolex. Alongside the two legal education leaders, we have got very unusually the professional leaders representing something of a matter of pride for me personally, the leaders in the form of women leaders, Ms. Seema Jingan, who is Lex Council's law office's founder, as well as we have Anu Sura, who is representing PSL Advocates. Now, the first question that we are going to consider here, or the concept that we are going to consider here, not sounding to be soothsayers or naysayers or houdinis of giving a kind of quick fix solution to the issues that legal education is facing. I would like to look at how does legal education stand today? Where are we? All of us are familiar with the last 2 weeks of the NLAT and CLAT war, making the repertoire for the courts and legalities, right from a few high courts to the Supreme Court, not being spared, where the figures of 70,000 aspirants for national law school entrance exam, a staggering figure, comes in front of us. On the other hand, we have got these national rankings within India, which is by the official arm of Ministry of Human Resource Development, as much as the NIRF or National Institutional Ranking Framework, as much as the ranking framework which is given by, let us say, Today, The Week, and some of the important highlights that business world also has brought to the consumers of legal education and stakeholders. Now, in this context, when we have so many aspirants for legal education in the leading law schools, there are a number of others who are also opting for other tiers of legal education. Bar Council's own report, Bar Council, this regulator of legal education, has published its own report on the curriculum, where it talks about different tiers of law schools in this country. So going by all of that, we have a very vibrant landscape of legal education, which for very long has been following the footsteps of its peers in the UK and in the US, and picking up best practices from other countries of the Commonwealth like Australia or from continental part of the world. Some of our best practices have been also taken by southern countries like Afro-Asian and Latin American countries. So what are these trends or best practices we have? First of all, the nomenclature of Indian legal education can be defined as the legal education that produces legal professionals. I wouldn't call them as producing lawyers alone. A legal professional is always a lawyer in the sense that one who uses the law. And a professional is the one who uses knowledge and skills on a strong footholding of ethics to public service. So in our profession, the core of public service, the core of skills and the core of values, how is it addressed in legal profession? And how is it addressed in legal education, which shapes these professionals, is the first question. Now, we can see that Indian legal education has received a lot of respect. It underwent so many phases. First of all, our legal education also was having a common root, like how the legal education evolved in the US two or three centuries ago, where initial lawyers were mentored by the professionals. However, when the institutes started offering full-time law programs, initially in India, we had 2-year law program, then 1 year of apprenticeship by the professional, and then 3-year law program. So we also went through our own stages of evolution in legal education to mark some of the watershed moment in history in terms of evolution of single disciplinary national law schools, which were considered as institutes of excellence at par with the Indian Institute of Management, the IIMs, and the Indian Institute of Technology, the IITs, and national institutes of medicine like the AIIMS. Now, by mid-80s, this movement started. But by mid-80s, another movement started at the Bar Council that was looking at legal education as full-time education and fully professional education at par with the medical education. Hence, started the 5-year law program. Till mid-80s, right from the colonial times, what we had was 3-year law program where the graduates would enter this program. So these are the different shades of legal education as we have today. However, when we come to the norm quality, there also we have different hues and shades. So definition of quality has been satisfaction of all stakeholders, simple definition. So in legal education, the stakeholders would be the state, which puts the norms in place and which also benefits from the legal education, which also defines, which regulates, which controls. We have the community, which is the beneficiary and the observer. We have the legal professionals in the form of advocates, and then other kinds of vocations where advocates are engaged, and they feeding the bench, the judges. And then we have a large number of other engagements where law graduates are engaged, where the stakeholders in terms of being students, in terms of being parents, in terms of being non-governmental organizations, business enterprises of various types. So when we situate legal education like this, and we compare it with the evolution of quality legal education movement elsewhere, I think India has crossed a very long distance within a very short span of time. However, this journey hasn't been easy, but it hasn't been uniform as well. The pace of evolution of our legal education institutions has been at different levels. So in this discussion, fortunately, we have got representatives from the lead private law schools, and the representatives having spent good number of years in the state-based universities and education system. And very interestingly, under 40 kind of leaders from the legal profession, as founders of the law firms and as leaders of the law firms, aside from the variety of audience that we have here. So in this context, today if we see, our profession is the only one which has got a place of respect in the Constitution, which is mentioned in the Constitution. Secondly, legal education in India today has more than 1,550 institutes offering legal education. And we have more than 25 national law schools included within this. We have about 700 state universities offering or affiliating these law schools. And then we have autonomous private institutes having these law schools as well. So Indian legal education is growing. Every year student body, for example, I had 21,000 applications for my 300 seats. That means for quality legal education, there's a large competition in this country, which shows that we have to soul search. Where is our legal education? What are the challenges that it's facing? As in today, aside from the demography of the age group that is legal education, that is dominant, 65% of the population, we have the challenge in terms of recent COVID-19 upsetting the apple cart in terms of not allowing us to have our experiential learning, our professional mentoring, our direct exposure to teaching, and having to go in the technology way. Whereas India's digital divide stands as a challenge with these 1,500 law schools. Aside from that, the second opportunity and the challenge that has come is from the recently announced national education policy, the new education policy. New education policy in a way sounds a review position for our current single discipline universities, the national law schools. It offers opportunities in terms of multidisciplinarity and interdisciplinarity. It gives opportunities even in terms of lateral entry and exit. So I set this stage and I invite my learned colleagues, maybe I will call you by name, to just enlighten our audience in the first round, what are the issues and challenges that we are facing in terms of these new developments, in terms of the quality, like in the US, we had Educating Lawyers report, which came from the Carnegie Foundation, which took the clue from the McBride Foundation, but it went ahead to say that still legal education does not have the professionalism which the medical education represents. So they said, let us have a very well-calibrated skills, knowledge, and values put in the legal education, featured in the legal education. And then in India, in the same line, some of the law schools are on a kind of commitment to provide such education to keep our competitive edge, to serve the national and global needs, and to create professionals with global competencies. And at the same time, to echo the same idea of putting legal education on the professional pedestal like medical education. So what are the issues and challenges if we were to look at it in terms of these two important developments of COVID and new education policy, in terms of fee, time, method, tiers of law schools, the issue of learning from home, the challenge of engaging them in active learning, to mention a few. There are many more. So I request now, first of all, coming from the professional side, what do you, Ms. Seema Jingan, think of this?
Thank you very much. First of all, a correction, I'm not under 40. I won't even qualify under 50. So that's a correction. Interestingly, I'm not an educator, so I may not be able to give a lot of insight into what the education policy looks like, except that I understand that the education policy is doing addressing one of the biggest challenges, which is to diminish the rote learning. I think that is one of the biggest issues that we as an education system have. Our workforce is completely unemployable, whether these are legal law graduates or otherwise. The employability, the learning outputs and quality of learning that they have learned at law schools are so poor. And I'm not talking about, since we have thousands of law colleges, and I'm not talking about some of the very good law colleges like yours and the other panelists, or for that matter, the NLUs, but there are thousands of other law colleges in the country, which is, I think, producing 1 lakh above law graduates every year. The biggest challenge as an employer and as an owner of a law firm that we face is that while they have understood the issues related to what a law is, certain subjects, but there are no nuances of a legal application. There are no understanding of legal There are so many skills that are required, which I will go in a lot of detail in the second part of the conversation. But I think the biggest challenge that is needed to be addressed, and COVID and the online education is one of the opportunity for that, is to go into a revamping of the education system, moving away from the rote learning to debate, research based, and with a lot of focus on actual reading, actual understanding, and going deeper into the research-based understanding, which brings in the critical and analytical capabilities of the law graduates. The kind of time we spend in training our associates when they join us raw, from the law colleges, and I'm talking about very, very good law colleges here, anything minimum from 6 months to 10 months, and that also depends on the quality of the law graduate. If a law firm is spending, let's say, 10 months to 12 months in training the associate, and by that time they want to move, go to another law firm, there is a lot of upturn around there. So one of the biggest challenges and an opportunity, I would say, is to turn around the rote learning, enabling the encompassing technology-based learning outputs into the education system, which brings out the lawyers at what an industry is looking out. And I'll go one by one into the outcomes that as an industry we're looking at into the second part of the question. But I think if you look at the national education policy which has come right now, it is in itself focusing on doing away with the rote learning. It is focusing heavily into research-based analysis. There's a proposal to set up a research fund for that so that the research can be funded. There's a proposal to not only augment the quality of students, but also augment the quality of teachers, which is the repetitive trainings and enhancement of skills of the teachers. The quality of teachers in India, in my mind, is one of the biggest challenges. I studied in one of a very premium institution in the 90s, and we had some of the best, the only, I would say, claim to fame of the institution was we were taught by MC Sharma and Upendra Bakshi and MC Mehta. There were such fabulous lawyers, and I think all my understanding or certain aspects of law which I've never practiced thereafter are based on the teachers and the quality of teachers. So augmenting the quality of learning of the teachers, which is part of the education policy, I think that's another aspect which I really appreciate. The other aspect, I think, is the education policy which was rightly captured is not only focusing on rote and research, but we've also gone on to create multidisciplinary systems of education. Why should a law student not be allowed to learn digital marketing as part of the curriculum? Why should a law student not be able to study arts? Why should a law student not be able to study, sociology and political environment in the country and part of some aspects of the media? And these are real issues which industry faces. And I think the new education policy, when they allow you to do multidisciplinary curriculum-based study, I think that's a pretty interesting dynamics.
Thank you, Ms. Seema. You have laid out very important skill gaps and very important observation about how legal education needs to respond to the emerging needs. Now, let me turn the attention towards Dr. Saleem, whose law school had a couple of years ago organized a very good faculty development program on improving the skills in the faculty so that they could translate or transact such skills to the students. So, Dr. Saleem, how do you respond to Ms. Seema's observation on skill gaps? And how does our curriculum respond to certain emerging areas such as technology or media or the upcoming application side? As she said, the important dimension of legal research. Over to you.
Good evening, Dr. Shashikala ma'am. Good evening, Dr. Tabrez sir, and Anusura ma'am and Seema ma'am. I have the privilege of being part of this panel, especially when two of my mentors are present here. I have worked under the guidance of Shashikala ma'am for 6 years in Symbiosis Law School, Noida. And I have the privilege of having her guidance directly to me. And Tabrez sir was my senior. He was on the third floor of the hostel and I was on the ground floor. And I always look up to him as my senior and guide. I feel privileged to have the association and working with PSL also, a few of their people. The question which Professor Shashikala ma'am has coined to me, which is very specific to what Seema ma'am has explained very elaborately, that yes, we accept that legal education drastically fails to produce, the current module of legal education drastically fails to produce professionals which are practice ready in any way, whether it is legal practice ready or profession ready or whatever it may be. Keeping in view the 1600 law schools which ma'am have just told us, that legal education in general actually failed to produce such kind of practitioners or professionals which are directly fit into, which are directly can be practice ready at all or profession ready at all, which is not with the medical education, as Professor Shashikala ma'am has just told us, that 5-year legal education or law education or BLLB or BCom LLB or BBLLB program was started because of this fact, that we wanted to equate ourselves with medical education. But nowhere we match with the medical education, because after medical education, MBBS and all that, a student who passes MBBS is ready for the practice. And the main factor which I see in my 17 or 20 years of legal education is because education institutions are kept aloof from the practice. So there are two most important aspects which have made this vacuum, which created this gulf. One is that institutions are aloof from the practice and profession. And second is, so this gap is filled by an ongoing internship, continuous internship, summer internship, winter internship kind of practices which are started by national law schools and Symbiosis and other premier legal education institutions in India. But largely with all the education institutions, this is not possible. Keeping into consideration, if we consider the position of 26 national law schools and 20 more private universities and best law schools in India. So not more than 50 we can count on hand on tips that students are in a position to have the infrastructure at least to be able to interact with the profession during their legal education. So unless and until, so I won't say that it is the fault of the student that they are not practiced. It is not the fault of the student that they are not practice ready. It is my fault. It is the fault of our education process. It is the fault of our education system or our legal education process that make us, that make those students defective product to be eligible to work in the industry. This can be filled partly by internships, yes. And secondly, this is something which can be filled by largely introducing practicing people from industry to teach in the classroom. Like I always try to do, to introduce a co-faculty from industry to teach alongside. Like I just have introduced one of the toppers of Symbiosis Pune, who has done LLM from Cornell, and she's working with Ketan and co in Bombay. And I got to introduce with her with some of my link, and I requested her to start company law. So one of my faculty alongside a practicing person in the firm is teaching the course. So that practice perspective of the subject has to be brought in the classroom. Unless we have to bring that practice perspective, a student will continue to see book as a complete universe. So we, unless we have to expose the student that book is the initial point, it is not the end point. Classroom is not the end of the of your education. It is the beginning of education. And practice or profession is something which is the place what you have to learn. So invitation or regular footfall of the industry people in the classroom and regular footfall of the student in the profession and practice, that is the only reason by which we can create, we can bridge this gap. And I hope, and whatever I know about American education process, whatever I know from English education process, I have the privilege that Professor Shashikala ma'am sent me to England for summer school in 2013. And I saw there during my symbiosis time that how they are in a position to equate, to create education institution as a breeding ground for the lawyers. It is not that they are just imparting education for the sake of imparting degrees, printing degrees. They don't print degrees for the sake of a capitalist mindset. They do it materially, empirically, for the purpose of catering to the practice and profession. And we lack in that, and we can, and always, ma'am has always been in the advisory board of the Bar Council of India, in University Grants Commission, in various other committees. They have all the ways to make the difference in that.
Thank you, Dr. Salim. You have brought out a very important point, taking a cue from Ms. Seema, on bridging the gap by linking the profession and the educational institution. Dr. Tabriz, we would be curious to know what other ways can come in terms of what we normally call as conceive this idea of a skill center, legal skill center, or in terms of simulation. We would be curious to know, in your vision, how do you further enhance this reduction of gap between actual profession and what we teach in classrooms?
Ma'am, whatever I have learned through my tenure with you, and whatever I learned through my experience in last 17-20 years, every law course has to have a practice, every law course has to have a practical aspect in it. 50% theory, 50% practical must have to be introduced with every subject. I teach a contract. If I do not teach how to draft the contract, my whole teaching of contract is futile. A student will know every principle, but he will not be able to draft even one page of a contract. He will always go to a draftman to draft a contract for him, even for a rent in which he is going to live in his tenure of law school.
Exactly. I'm very curious to know from Dr. Tabriz Ahmed, because he is also the founder of an organization. So over to you, Dr. Tabriz, the Pro Vice Chancellor and team from TD Goenka. I'd be very happy to give your wisdom to the audience. Yeah, please.
It is very nice to have a very learned panel, and also you actually driving the panel, so much experience and knowledge, and also we have Dr. Salim, and we have two practicing lawyers, so it's a very balanced panel to drive the particular kind of the topic. So I'm a very strong believer about the content and the curriculum of the law courses, because you rightly mentioned that there are 1550 law school, and if you see the curriculum of the at least 1500 law schools, it may not be as per the market requirement. I'm a very strong believer of the market, that we have to always customize and change the curriculum as per the changing market. But if you see the curriculum and also see the kind of the syllabus taught, barring these 50 top law school, some NLUs and some of the private good law school, it is hardly changed in the 4 or 5 years. And we should, the way market is changing, we have to change every semester. And we have to customize the curriculum as per the changing market. Because if see from 1991, the way market has changed, export, import, the balance of payment, and also the financial crimes have after a lot of the efforts, still we every time, every year we see a lot of the financial crimes happening. People are leaving the country, going to the foreign country. And then the way the technology has taken over, and also what we have seen in the COVID period, now cyber crimes are tripled, domestic violence are doubled. So all these, why actually we are not able to tackle these problems? So I'm a strong believer that we have to first decide that, and every time we have to customize that, what should be the curriculum. For example, currently the way the this information technology is taking over, and the way the AI is coming over, we are going to see a lot of technology taking over a lot of the efforts and work of the lawyers. So the question is that now what are the future skill sets required? Now we have to filter out, we have to remove those of the content which is very old, which is not required. Because if you are going to teach already law that is changed or amended, there is no role to play in the market or in the corporate world or in the family setup or during the practice. And we have to see also the future, because if you're going to teach right now, they're going to go in the market after 5-6 years. So we have not to see just right now, we have to see the market, changing market in future. So that's why we have to change the curriculum and syllabus, keeping in mind the content area. And also we have to see that how we are going to incorporate those skills, because some of the skills which we are thinking that is required by a lawyer may be taken over by the blockchain technology, by the artificial intelligence, machine learning. Now, then in those scenarios, there are a lot of new skills are required. Okay, because see, if you see currently as a lawyer, I think they agree, Seema Jingam and also the Anu can agree with me, that the kind of skill is required by a lawyer, he has to have very holistic perspective. Because if you see earlier days, as an IPR lawyer, you are just supposed to either file the grant of the IPR or for the commercialization, or just simply go and litigate the IPR matter. But currently, you have to also understand the entire portfolio, just like the how to get quickly the IPR, how to go for the licensing, how to handle, whether to handle the IPR litigation or not, whether to go for out of the court settlement, how to commercialize the particular IPR, and this way how to see the global market. Because India being the signatory of the TRIPS agreement, one of the patent grant to a particular company, he has the entire world, all signatory countries as a market. So in that case, the lawyer can guide, lawyer can be an advisor, he can be a consultant, he can be a guide that how you can go to the, give the license to throughout the world. Okay. So my point is that now the requirement of a lawyering skill includes even the financial market understanding, social market understanding, and also they have to understand the kind of the psychology of the kind of the market, and also the way the entire system is changing. So it means that we have to review the entire content and include those portions which are future requirements, and also exclude those portions which is already gone or maybe taken over by the blockchain technology or by the artificial intelligence. Second issue is that now how we are going to kind of the have the pedagogy for the learning process, because the old method of just like the spoon feeding has gone. Now we have to impart new methods, and we have seen the COVID-19 period. At least best thing is that, because I'm speaking from 1995, let us include lot of the IT thing in the teaching learning process. But if you see, with due respect to all the old professors, if you are trying to include the PPT by young faculty, they will laugh. They will say, oh my God, this young faculty is not understanding, and he is just trying to use the PPT to avoid the in-depth knowledge. But this is not the whole purpose. Purpose is that by using the multimedia in the classroom, you're going to engage the entire classroom, and you're going to save a lot of time. If still there are a lot of faculty, if you go to the government school, with due respect, they still provide the notes. Can you think in this advanced period, can you think about the notes? Because there are a lot of very advanced online journals. Even currently, if you go and access the journals, it will tell about the...
If I may interrupt you, because you have brought very important points which require reflection by our another panelist who has not yet started speaking. So we will continue with this point, because the point that you have raised can be summarized as you have very beautifully said with a lot of command on how the curriculum should be reviewed, why the curriculum should be reviewed, how curriculum should be developed in terms of future direction of the legal education. Now, I'll pause you there. We will continue in the next round of discussion quickly. And I turn the discussion towards Advocate Anusura from two points of view. One is, do you think from all the panelists' wise viewpoints we have gathered that there's a large percentage of graduates who are not practice ready or profession ready? Secondly, there is a need for also reviewing the curriculum. Do you think there is a need for reskilling as the new education policy says? Over to you.
Thank you, ma'am, for the question first. And so the answer to your first question, as Seema, ma'am, rightly pointed out, is yes. However, what we need to look at is that the reason behind that is very systemic, right? So barring a few national law colleges and the big universities, we need to look at the whole gamut of law students that come out of law schools, and the approach has to be very inclusive. right? So when we talk about students from NLUs and students from popular law schools, I wouldn't say that they aren't equipped with the skill sets, because as an employer, what I would look at is whether they have an aptitude for research, whether they have good communication skills or not, whether they have an attitude of problem solving or not, whether they can think like a lawyer or not. Training them is partly my responsibility as well, which happens in every other field also, right? But if we think about students who come from other law schools who are probably not very privileged in that sense, if we need to address the problems there. Now, the problems there are very systemic, right? And we need to have a very inclusive approach when we look at the problem of employability from an employer's perspective. So as Dr. Salim rightly pointed out, that that the change has to happen at two levels. First is at the college level, where of course the curriculum has to be really diverse. And the method adopted for imparting that knowledge has to be very practical, right? So I'm very fortunate to have studied in Delhi University, where we had a case law approach to education, right? Right. So that sort of gave us an insight into a lawyer's mind as well as a judge's mind as to how a judge, while applying its judicial mind to facts, is going to think, right? So that training started right there. So that is one thing. Another very important aspect that Dr. Salim pointed out was that empaneling more and more lawyers to teach at least the procedural law subjects in colleges, which I think is really important from the students' perspective as well, right? Then the second level of difference comes with internships. Now, having done my law not fairly recently, but some 5 years ago, and having interacted with a lot of students while I was teaching at Delhi University, and also when I interact with a lot of young students right now, one of the major issues that they grapple with is scoring good internships, right? I see students tensed all the time about scoring good internships, about making time for their internships, right? And that, according to me, is not merely important from a training point of view, but is also important from the point of view of students making an informed decision. So I see a lot of students having a very romanticized idea of litigation and getting very disillusioned 1 or 2 years into the profession, because they haven't really had the kind of exposure that an internship gives them, right? So I think interning a lot at varied sort of places, and I'm not just talking about internship at the bar. I'm talking about, say, interning with a policy think tank, right? Exploring if they have interest in academia. Are we equipping our students to make an informed choice at all? Do they know that they do have a choice to get into academics? They know that they do have a choice to get into
education. That's a very good point, that our legal education can have 5 different kinds of outcome in terms of professions like academics, state-based, court-based, and industry-based. Now, we have only 5 minutes as per the organizers to wrap up. So my quick question, if you could respond in 2 sentences only to Ms. Seema, is that what are the suggestions you have in terms of improving the outcome for future from the legal education to align with the future needs? Quickly in 1 or 2 lines, please.
Sure. I think the most important part of the education system would be that you will have to bring syllabus and curriculums in the colleges, which focuses on 5 different aspects. One is the intensity of deep reading. The lawyer should, during their curriculum, be taught the quality of reading, being able to bring out the unimportant facts from the non-important facts, the deep understanding of communication skills, the development of critical and analytical skills, which can only happen based on research base, which is case law, and practical internship, which Anu has said. So it has to be a research and combination of practical understanding of actual practice. That's one. I would say the critical thinking techniques have to be improvised. most important, when the lawyer, law graduates comes to law firm, they are definitely not ready for long hours of work. It's a shock. Attitude building. I think this education system is not about teaching curriculum, not about teaching only the syllabus. It is also building life skills and life skills, time management skills, management of professional etiquettes and attitudes. I think one of the very good things that Anu mentioned was the attitude to learn, attitude to research, attitude to put in your 120%, because it's a very, very tough profession. I think these are the skills were completely absent from majority. I'm talking about a holistically majority basis law graduate. And just knowing torts, contract, constitution does not constitute them as a law graduate. The essential four pillars of their law practice is communication skills, drafting skills, analytical skills, and research Absolutely. Skills. All are mostly missing. I think that's something that the law college has to must.
Yeah, so
must
we need to have a very structured skill metric, which could also include stress management skill. Like there is a lot of suicide rates and mental health issues with the law students as well as professionals. Yes. So quickly, Dr. Salim, in one line, what would be your takeaway in terms of how to improve and make legal education future ready, please?
Ma'am, thank you so much. I would very briefly, only in two lines, would give my point of view. The first of all, teaching learning and working learning balance. We have to create two sorts of learning, working learning and teaching learning, balancing of both and accreditation or giving credit to both equally. Equilibrium of working learning like internship or that kind and teaching learning. And the other thing which I would be saying second is AI. Let's say if there is a practice, before practice there is an exam, AIB. So there has to be a strict AIB exam like on the pattern of America. There should not be a mockery of, there should not be a kind of joke of examination in the name of AIB, which even a 12th class okay. pass out will clear now.
Yeah.
Without even having a legal education. These are the two points which I would say on this
panel. So it
Thank
adds
you so much,
to the
ma'am.
Quality. So Professor Tabriz, please, quickly.
We have to focus on the outcome-based learning because the NBA and all the groups already decided the outcomes. But till now in legal education, we are not able to find out what is the outcome. Why we have BBLLB, why we have BBLLB, BSLLB, BTECLLB. And we have to have very focused outcome-based learning process. And in that case, customized to the market requirement, we'll use a lot of the technology and a lot of the kind of online resources. And also, we have to build up a lot on the soft skill. Very nicely mentioned by the Seema that we have to be very passionate, hunger for desire, compassion, and humility. And these are very, very important aspects to sustain and survive in the market.
Sir, with the due respect and with the lot of curiosity and appreciation for your term market focused, I have a little difference there, because legal education and legal profession as such is the defender of the constitution and constitutional guarantees. Legal education as one of the attributes of rule of law should be in consonance with that. So even if I agree with your market-centric focus and updation, I would also say it is to humanize the market. It is to make the market to be justice-oriented and not forgetting that our major outcome is to create justice defenders. So let's ask Anu, who is a practicing lawyer, how she would view it in terms of quick takeaway from this discussion to be future ready, legal education. Yeah.
Ma'am, I will take you from what you rightly pointed out, that legal education is not really about using commercial lawyers as such. And I remember reading an article by late Dr. Shamnad Bashir, who rightly pointed out that legal education is supposed to produce social engineers, right? Then it is up to the students to take it forward as to if they want to take the path to, say, a proper litigation or arbitration, or they want to take up constitutional law litigation, or they want to get into academia, etc. Another important point that Dr. Salim pointed out was the quality control at the level of bar exam, which is, I think, is the need of the hour. If we need quality control, I think quality control has to happen there. Then, as Kana also very rightly pointed out, we need to equip our students with proper skill sets of using research tools of writing, of drafting, of equipping them with good communication skills, etc. So I think the future of legal education is going to be very bright if we have a very all-inclusive and interdisciplinary approach as such.
Wonderful. So thank you, dear panel. Each one of you has enriched this great discussion, and you have given a lot of good pointers for the future. As I wind up, I would like to summarize that we had great points such as being very responsive to the surrounding, including the market, reskilling, and what could be the possible ingredients in the skilling, how could this profession be taken at a different level, how legal education could improve its quality in terms of its response to the profession, and how profession could enrich the curriculum in terms of reviewing and rebuilding, have been the main takeaways. And the most important point was about inclusive approach in legal education, and legal education as an arbiter of social justice and making human resource capable for national building and community building. So thank you for very rich contribution. But last but not the least, I would like to add 2 points. One is what Ms. Seema pointed out in terms of 21st century skills, which included critical and evaluative thinking, life skills, among many other things. And second is in a digital society, to have digital quotient incorporated, as Dr. Tabriz pointed out, in terms of data science, data privacy, and a lot of these new developments which are coming up at the global level to be incorporated into the curriculum, and enriching the curriculum by proper give and take between the variety of profession and the space of the students. All of us are dealing with the millennials, so the millennials are very, very tech savvy. Let's not forget that. And the future generation is not about another century in these days. It's about another year or another decade. So we hope that all the good points that we have discussed here will be taken into the fold of legal education and legal profession. I thank the organizers, and I thank my esteemed panelists once again and the audience. I'm not sure if there are question answer sessions. I don't see any, but I'm sure that there will be a lot of questions which could be personally directed to our panelists or to any of us or to the organizers. It has been a great evening, and I have personally enriched myself with your wise company. All the best to one and all.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Rehman. Thank you so much. A big thank you to all the leaders in education for sharing their stimulating talk on the landscape for future legal education in India. What an enlightening session this was. Thank you very much.